Okay, so the recording is on, and Lyubov, I let you maybe present the speaker.
Yeah, perfect. So I'm really happy to present Geoffroy Berthelot, with whom we met at the Ecole Polytechnique when we both were working in condensed matter physics lab and in the Laboratoire de Mathématiques Appliquées, CMAP, which I think some people here, at least Mikhail, knows here. And it's a small world, right? So I think that Geoffroy will let us also know a bit of history about the subject, which he will talk about. It will be about the common papers also, which we worked on with Geoffroy and other co-authors. So the floor is yours. Thank you for coming.
Thank you. Should I be starting now?
Yeah.
Okay. So today, I will speak about evolution of physical flow in complex network. It's a work that we have done and we are still working on with Lyubov and many other people. Maybe I should speak about how it started. Maybe some of you knows people in this slide. Actually, the work started with the collision between Bernard and Christos, if I remember well. It was during a meeting at the Ecole Polytechnique. And the idea was to study transportation in a complex network. During this meeting, we also met with Denis and Min, and of course, Lyubov. And we start thinking about how should we describe transport in complex network, because actually complex network are very well studied in the literature. And transport in complex network is also studied, but you will see that it's studied in a specific way, and we try another approach. So much of people in this line know each other, mainly for working on the topic of flow in airways tree, for instance.
And maybe just to add that actually Bernard, if you come back to the slide with Bernard, he was initiator of this study. He's known indeed in his work, prominent work in studies of transport in lungs. And as Geoffroy also said, right, he was initiator. They met at the conference with Christos, and afterwards Bernard, with his incredible motivation, came to us, and we could not say no to what he suggested, although it looked from the first perspective it looked very unclear what was the goal to do. But I need to tell also that Bernard, he's not with us anymore now. Unfortunately, he died this year, and he was one of the most incredible physicist I knew. He was experimentalist who converts to theorist, which is very rare, right? And also second thing about him was that he was one of the not students, but yeah, almost students from Mandelbrot, right? So he's from that kind of right family. So he was very known in that area. And Christos already came once to the network seminar, so you know him. Thank you.
So to sum up about the physical flow in complex network, there are a lot of examples in the literature and applications and example of networks. I just put a short list here, but it's very used in biological networks and nature. I can't list all the application and example, it's very difficult. So I just put some of the most common here. It's very, if I remember well, Christos had the specialty in transportation network where he studied the effect of link removal in network when, for instance, you have a volcano in a small island that prevent airplanes crossing the Atlantic. So that was a speaking example of how removal of link in a network can alter the transport. here are some
just one question, sorry, about the previous slide. So here you're talking about degree in the transportation network, or you're talking about fluxes, like this scalp free distribution? Yeah.
I just don't want to tease too much my presentation.
Okay.
Because I will speak about flux in complex network. But mostly the presentation is about transportation and how we can set up the transport in complex network. So we use flux. But from now on, I'm just speaking about complex network are used and how a physical flow in complex network are usually viewed in nature.
Okay.
So we have many examples in the literature. We have many data sites where we have data when we can retrieve data and draw magnificent complex network like this. They are typically characterized by an exponent gamma that gives us the proportion of high degrees node in the network. So you can see that this network appears very different from one another, but they are all characterized by a degree distribution that is related to K exponent minus gamma.
So in the last example, can you go back one slide? The adjacency matrix looks
very dense.
Completely dense, but there's actually significant structures that I would expect on the left representation, where I would expect almost a stochastic block model to work, like two maybe dense partitions. Is it just the size of the points maybe on the matrix that is too big to actually show?
So yeah, but maybe you're just a presentation mistake, but
It's a very interesting point also, because I remember that at the network workshop, which Mark and his group were organizing at Cree, there was one point that where you said, okay, in fact, by looking at the matrix, right, you also can get some information. And that's exactly this case, right?
So I was saying, actually, even more than that, that you don't see information, you see artifacts as well. And for example, what I like is the first one, the first adjacency metric of the drosophila. You see that there's something about the neuron number 1,500 or something like that, that is really awkward, right? Yeah. Or you see that it's very like, so you do see information indeed that it's not necessarily easy to see in the left, because seeing hubs in a hairball is hard. But on the right, you see that there's this cross hub in a way. So that's nice, yeah.
Sorry, Geoffroy.
Yeah.
Could you just explain a little bit more the adjacent matrix and the degree distribution here?
Yeah. On the left side, you have the graph. So it's just a representation of the network. Yeah. The adjacency matrix corresponds of the link between each node. For instance, at the node 1,000, you can see that the node 1,000 is connected to node almost 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and then to node 600, 700, and so on. So it gives an information on how the nodes are connected. So it gives us some kind of structural information about the network. And as Marx just said, it's useful because here you can see that there is some kind of artifact occurring in the data, because there is one node that is almost connected to all other nodes. So that's kind of strange. But we have some kind of artifact when we download data from the internet, so it may be an issue with the data. It's not just obligatory or representative of what is in the data, so it may be a bug. But so it's useful because also there is a density of the data in the adjacency matrix. If the adjacency matrix is paired, there is a lot of holes in the adjacency matrix, you can see that many nodes are not connected one another. It gives you an information of the density of connectivity. I'm not sure it's a correct word, but it's just to give you an idea. And on the right, you have the degree distribution. It gives you an idea about how many the distribution of degree. So for instance, you have For the two first examples, you have many nodes that have a low degree. Mm-hmm. So they are almost 1 or 2 degrees. They are connected only to 1 or 2 nodes, and you have almost no nodes that are a very high degree.
And so this gamma parameter, its value is actually specific for road maps or drosophil or, yeah, or brain networks or that kind of thing.
Yeah, it's specific to each network I have plotted here. And actually, in the literature, there are some projects that are trying to categorize the network using gamma. Because there is a lot of, usually gamma range between 2 and 3. And so they are trying to make categorization of a network of different examples regarding the gamma value. So maybe there is some kind of a structural existence of gamma for natural networks and over for artificial networks, for example. Yeah. But I don't know very much about all this dictionary of gamma, but I know it's going on.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I would say even it's not just gamma, right? People are trying to fit different types of distribution than scale free, the log normal, vibrio, like different types. And there is the exponential cutoff as well, etc. But Mikhail, in a way, the gamma is kind of giving mechanistic insights of like what is a potential mechanism that can lead to such a distribution.
Okay.
If I detail our proposal setup, the idea was to study transport in complex system using the electrical Kirchhoff current law. So basically, we use a complex network that is an arrangement of n nodes on a square lattice. We don't want for the transportation self loops and what we call dead ends. It's isolated nodes that has a degree of 1. Because if we put such nodes in the network, the transport will reach a dead end and we don't want that.
So you mean that you don't authorize any feedback loops in your models of network?
No, it's the opposite.
Actually, I don't know what exactly you call feedback loops, but self loops, what we call self loops, is a node that is looping on itself. So he has a connection with himself.
Ah, you mean directly on himself?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because it will lead to not solving the adjacency, the matrix. But I'm speaking a bit too much about the rest of the slide, so I would prefer just to go smoothly. So Christos, for example, studies the transport of complex network with multiple source and drains. In our example, we mostly focused on one source and one drain in this network. So on the right, you have a picture of what would be a typical setup in our experimentation. We randomly pick one source and we randomly pick one drain. And we set a flux starting from the source and going out from the networks at the drain. So the flux is irrigating through all the nodes of the network. That's why we don't want dead ends. We don't want isolated nodes that are not part of the network. We want the network to have at least one connection to 2 other nodes. This is important because we also want to study the effect of distance. Because when you have 2 nodes that are connected, they can be very distant from one another or very close from one another. And we want to use some kind of weighting. For instance, if 2 nodes are very distant, we can imagine that the flux is difficult to reach from one node to one distant node. And on the contrary, if 2 nodes are close, we can imagine that the flux can go easily from one node to another. For picturing that, we use beta, coefficient beta, and we study all the possibilities related to distance. For instance, when beta is equal to -1, we having two nodes very, very separated is beneficial. When having beta equals to zero, it means that the distance has no effect. And on the contrary, when having beta is equal to one, it means that the distance has a negative effect. And I speak about the Euclidean distance.
It's. I mean, I use the 1/r case because in neural systems, you do have at least probabilities to connect that are decreasing as 1/r in this special network. So I could understand such a choice. But the one proportional to r, is it just a play with the model, or is it something that in some systems you actually know is happening, that the further you are, you actually increase the weight? Like plane systems?
That's a good question. Actually, it was just a play for the model, but we can probably imagine some system where it's true.
Like plane systems could be like that. Maybe you have more transports between Dubai and Paris than between maybe, I don't know, Paris.
Exactly.
And France, right? Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Very good. Okay.
So I just give you the result. As a straight answer, we simulate a number of complex networks. The wiring is stochastic, so we have to simulate a number of networks for different values of gamma and beta. And with all these simulations, we found that at each time, the network and the transport network is organized. So it means that there is an auto-organization of the network to ensure the following distribution of transport in the networks. It means that you have the flux that is starting at the source to the drain, and you have an arborescence structure starting from the source until we reach some kind of very massive structure that we called quasi-equipotential cluster that consists principally of links with small current and a lot of links, and then the transport go through this quasi equipotential cluster to reach the drain. And in all our simulation, we end up with this structure, and it does not depend on gamma and beta. It means that this structure happens every time, but provided we use the Kirchhoff current law. For this study, we do not use any other kind of law. We could imagine use some different, very different law, but we didn't do that. So this is important because, as I will speak, the next step of our work is about percolation and evolution. And at this moment, at this stage, we think that there is something happening in the quasi-equipotential cluster. So I'm starting to speak about percolation and evolution. So maybe of you maybe familiar with percolation theory. Typically, in percolation theory, we remove nodes and not links. So it has been very studied by many famous authors during the past decades. But in our approach, we were interested in removing links instead of nodes. And we choose three strategies. One that is a random strategy that is very common in percolation theory when you remove just a random node. In our case, we just remove a random link. And we choose another very specific strategy when we remove the useless or the weakest link, the link that carries the least current. So, from our point of view, it corresponds to removing useless links. It means that we have a huge network filled with a lot of links that are not very useful in terms of transport, and we try to remove these links, meaning that the useless links correspond to the links that have the least current. And we have another strategy that is to remove the strongest link. So we take our network and we remove the links that has the strongest current. And this one is very brutal.
Yes. I want to make a comment here, maybe from the experimental side, that I'm not sure if Darwinian in a way is the best term, because weak ties can be very fit for some purposes. And actually, in social sciences, the work of the Granovetter on the strength of weak ties showed that for social network, weak links that have very low transport of information, like people you don't know very much or don't connect with very often, are actually very important for your access to external resources. And therefore, they can be useful to some level, for example, for information transport, but maybe it's different than physical transport. But I just want to mention that in the context of information transport, weak ties might be actually, more important than strong ones.
That's an interesting point, because we study physical transport in complex network, but at one stage we thought about using this setup in the context of social networks, because there is some kind of information that is flowing through the network. So it's equivalent to a quantity of transport of a quantity through the network. So yes, the term is probably not adapted to all cases.
I think it works because here you're studying one community. It's not, you don't have communities structure, right? It's not a stochastic block model. So this would only be relevant if you had strong communities and they would be tied by weak links. And therefore you would see that removing them changes absolutely the structure and render inaccessible some stuff, right? Because it creates islands. But you're not really in the context where that can happen, I guess, in that model.
No, not yet.
Okay.
Speaking about evolution one more time, so we evolve our network. I'm not sure the term is quite correct, but we attack or we evolve our network. We stop evolution when we cannot evolve the network anymore, or there is no path between the source and the drain, for instance.
At each step, you remove, the weakest link. So you remove the weakest link, you see how your system changes, then you remove the weakest link again.
Yes.
And you do this until you don't have any modification of the network anymore.
Exactly.
Okay.
But this is for the pseudo-Darwinian cases. Yeah. For the other strategy, we move the strongest or the random link.
Yeah. Okay.
And we focus actually on three quantities. One that is very important to us is the total flux that is coming from the source, such as we can measure what is the strong of the, what is the force of the current originating from the source. We normalize this quantity with the initial total flux we have in our network, because at each evolution step, we remove some links and we expect this quantity to change. We also have another quantity of information that is time t. We call it time, but actually it's more like a step, because at each step you remove one link. So we call it time, but it can be seen as a step. And we normalize this time with a number of links at the initial stage of the network, because we don't want the number of links to change our time of collapse. And the last quantity is the time of collapse. That is the time when just the evolution stops. On the right, you have a small illustration of what happens. Here you have several networks that are evolved, and the time of collapse is just a measure of the time when the evolution stops. It means that from one of the three cases you cannot find a path between the source and the drain, or there are no move links to remove, you stop the evolution. So it is the time when the evolution stops. So here it's a big figure. It's the main result of the article we published this year. From the left to the right, you have an increase in the gamma value, and from the top to the bottom, you have an increase of the beta values. So what we see with this, the green are the strongest strategy. So you can see that the network, the transport in the network collapses very fast, because you remove the strongest link first. from the blue lines, if this is the random strategy, when you remove a random link of the network, and the red one is the pseudo-Darwinian strategy when you remove the weakest link in the network at each time step. So we can see that in the case of the stronger network, the transport collapses very soon. From the random strategy, it collapses much later. And for the pseudo-Darwinian strategy, it's even later. It means that with the pseudo-Darwinian strategy, the transportation keeps its property for a longer time. Now, if we take a look at different gamma and beta value, we can see that beta doesn't appear to change something. It doesn't seem to affect this collapse of the transport of the network. Whereas when we increase gamma, you can see that there is always the same net decreasing pattern, but you can see that it's a bit longer what you have for lower value of gamma. It means that when you have hubs in your network, it seems that the transport is more resilient to attacks. Do you have any question? Because it's some
yes.
kind of, yeah.
Little question. So I'm not completely able to see what you said with the increasing gamma, because by eye like that, it's hard for me to see what I should. It looks very similar to me, all of them in a way. So what is exactly the clear difference when I increase gamma? Is it in the green ones, or where do you see a real big difference?
It's the time to collapse. That is decreased.
Yeah.
The time of the collapse is all at 10 minus 3, right?
No.
For instance, in the upper panels, mm-hmm. you have from 2, 3, 4. Here you have a time of collapse of the red that is almost 1 for gamma equal 2. For 3, it's a bit less. And for gamma equal 4, it's a bit less again. So it's not a strong effect, but it's an effect.
Okay.
But are you clear? It's not obvious. It's not something very, very strong, but it appears.
And so, I know these figures indeed for node removal. And for node removal, basically a node removal is like removing a bunch of links altogether, right? Correlated links in a way. Do you have any comparison in mind? Like, did people actually do removing nodes in transportation network with these kind of strategies? Do you have an equivalent for that?
No, I know Lyubov have more explanation than me, because I'm not an expert in percolation in nodes. I know that Avelin did a lot of stuff of work in a percolation theory removing nodes. But I'm not aware, and I didn't compare with the two. We didn't do that. It could be a point of interest, because it's not really the same thing. When you remove nodes, as you said, you remove a lot of links at the same time. And when you remove links, you just remove one link, and the network reorganize. So it will be interesting to see the compare the two. I think that removing nodes would be worse than removing link.
And because actually, I think it's very interesting, this approach, because in biology, and Mikhail is here, so that's perfect. In biology, people have for a long time looked at node removal, thinking, okay, when you have a disease or a mutation, it affects a protein, and it's like removing or like rendering that node not as effective, and that's a perturbation.
Yes.
Recently, people have done what they call edgeotyping. Edgeotyping is looking at the effect of mutation on the existence of a link between two proteins. So they look now at perturbation of whether it removes the link or reorganizes the link to another protein. And they look at how random mutation can affect the interaction network of proteins. So in a way, it could be interesting to think, like, this looks very robust to me, these random attacks. And indeed, maybe the protein interaction networks or biological networks are wired in a way that they're resilient to edge attack, but not necessarily optimizing for node attack. So I like this approach.
Yeah, I think it was stated by Bernard a long time ago about airflow in lungs, when our lungs are very, how I would say that, unoptimal. They are not optimal because when you have an optimal network, cutting one link means that you probably kill the network because you don't just end up with a chain of nodes with degree two. So it means that when you cut a link, this link is very important for the network. So you alter the functionality of the network. And we will see that in the next slide. Here's a small video. It's a description of the evolution of one network when we cut the weakest link for the pseudo-Darwinian strategy. So I will play it. So the center part is a quasi-equipotential cluster. So you see that the attacks start very in this area. It takes some time. Up, we reach at the end of the evolution. And here we have the most basic network possible for ensuring transportation between the source and the drain. Provided we only accept degree is equal to two. So you can have just a line between the source and the drain, but the minimal condition for us is a degree equal to two.
But when you do random removal of the edges,
yeah,
you can randomly remove an edge which is outside of your QEC, right?
Yes, there is a large proportion of links in the QEC.
Okay, so it's unlikely.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. But it happens sometimes that you remove a link that is connected to the source or the drain, and that is very much prejudicial. I don't know how to say that in English, but it's very dangerous for the network.
But because, so, yeah. Does it mean that you have a strong rearrangement of your QEC, or in that case, or?
At this stage, when you remove a link connected to the source or the drain?
A link that is outside of the QEC. Yeah.
Yeah, outside of the QEC, we don't really know, but I think it alters the network very fast. And we don't know how this rearranges the QEC. We didn't study that at this moment. Because you have plans to study the role of the QEC in the evolution.
And so did you check at how gamma changes inside the QEC around the transition?
No, we didn't check that.
Okay.
One thing we can state for sure is that we have no effect of beta when we remove the weakest link. And the figure is a bit complicated, but for the inset, you have the frequency of the time of collapse that is normalized by the initial number of link. And when we try the distribution of the time of collapse, you can see that if you change beta, there is no difference in the distribution of the time of collapse. So for us, it's not really a surprise because we already saw that in the first study. But what questions us a lot is this figure, because when we just plot the time of collapse against the average link per node, we just obtain this very, very, very flat curve. And we could not explain this at this stage. We have no explanation. So we don't know why the time of collapse is so easily related to the raw average link per node. it has to be investigated. I can't hear you, Lyubov.
We can't hear you well, it's very far. We don't hear you. Okay, we hear you again. No, yeah, we can't hear you. Okay.
Anyway. So actually, we are working on several directions. We think we can find some kind of optimal pair source drain that allows the network to withstand attacks. For instance, in the upper right graphic, you have the distance between the source and drain. And you can see that when you increase the distance between the source and the drain, when I mean distance is the distance in the number of nodes. When you have many nodes between the distance between the source and the drain, you can see that the time of collapse is very small. Very small, it's smaller than when you have a small distance between the source and the drain. So we are investigating what are the properties of the source and the drains that allow the network to be resilient to attack. We also are looking at the adjacency matrix.
It's in the context of the case where you remove the strongest ties.
Here it's for the weakest.
It's for the Darwinian one, okay.
Yeah. Actually, for the strongest strategy, we always have the same result. It means that the network collapses very fast.
Okay, whatever the distance.
Yeah, we didn't find any parameter that would allow the network to withstand strong attack. But I don't know if it's difficult to find or not. We are trying to find parameter or structural properties of the network that would allow the network to be very resilient. But for the strongest attack, I think it removes links from the source and the drain, and the networks collapse very fast.
Is it something like, because if they're closer, the intermediate layer has more redundancy, while if they're further apart, it means for the same node size, same number of nodes, you have more of a chain-like structure, and so higher probability to collapse quickly? Actually, the number of nodes is constant here, so basically the closer...
Yeah.
I know, because...
The number of nodes is constant. It's always 100.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, okay. That's.
So it's just an insight of what we are doing now, because we have many other options to study the resilience of the network. We are currently working on the structure of the network, where we are trying to try to find structural properties of the adjacency matrix that will result in a larger TC. And for another work, we are currently trying to assess the role of the QEC compared to trees. Well, I call that trees, but I'm not sure it's a tree. It's just some kind of arborescent structure originated from the source and from the drain and colliding at the center. And this kind of structure has no QEC. It means that there is a layer that a lot of connection in the center, but there are no, all the links are not in the QEC. So I think this is quite different from a complex network. So are they completely different or are we very close? We are actually investigating this kind of stuff. And of course, if you have interesting example, that could allow us to illustrate our approach, it would be very interesting.
Similar to this tree structure, I'm more knowledgeable, not in physical transport, but I'm more knowledgeable on information transport. And in biology especially, it's called pathways. And these are signaling pathways that transmit a signal from the membrane, which could be your source, to some genetic element in the nucleus, and that would be your drain of information in a way. And the way they organize these pathways tend to look a bit more what you're showing us here, which is this redundant path. And redundancy is useful for many regards. But so I'm wondering, because you're trying to build the kind of like to investigate some kind of best structure, best network, most resilient network structure, let's say given a source and a drain that are fixed, what would be the best intermediate structure? It seems to me like this kind of resilient, this kind of redundant path that you show, where, how to say, some edges can be, how to say, redundant with many others in the sense of having very, very, very similar path structure, like minimum path structure between the source and the drain that goes through them, would be interesting. So not a between a centrality value, but something that would be a similarity value between two edges that, you know, each edge would have at least one or two other similar ones, right?
Yeah, actually, it's interesting that here that you talk about between us, because, for example, Shlomo and Eugenie Stanley, the fathers of condensed metaphysics, they actually exactly, they were trying to also remove some nodes with, depending on the between us centrality, right? In order to find the fastest, this what you call redundant path, actually. Right.
So that's between us centrality, but here I'm even thinking about the fact that any, for any edge, so you can compute, it's not just a value, but you could say, okay, I'm in a path, you know, that above me there's such a weight, below me there's such a weight, and or like a distance to the drain, and you can find other edges that have a similar kind of shortest path or like local structure around them that makes them look visually like, if you look on the this basically symmetry, if you look on your diagram, you can see that the node 6 around the node 6, the arrangement, the local arrangement is basically the same than around node 9 and around node 12. And these edges have almost similar types, like as in like structurally speaking. And what I'm thinking about is like, is there a way to measure this structural redundancy? Because I feel it's both global and local. And I feel that something that would give insight on your resilience to go from the source to the drain, right?
Yes, thank you. It's a good, very good idea. no kidding. Because we are trying to simulate trees and comparing them to a complex network. But an indication of a local structure would be very interesting.
And I feel so the way people look at these things, one way, but it's computationally intensive. But one way is to look at so in biology, they call that genetic interactions, but it's basically antagonisms where, for example, say you remove one edge and you have a delta, like a decrease of the global flow of, I don't know, delta I, and you remove another link and you have a decrease of flow of delta J. And then you remove both of them and you have a delta tilde, and that would be much, much bigger than the sum of delta I and delta J. That would be an antagonism where if you remove both of them, you really, really much harder hit than each of them individually would have done. Okay. And so this kind of, it's basically 2-point correlation, but at the level of edge removal, right? But that means that you need to scan, instead of just removing one edge, you need to scan the effect of pairs. And that gives an idea of the degree of redundancy of two edges, because that gives an idea if one is basically saving the whole thing for the other, right? So maybe looking at this coupling effect could be a way to go a bit beyond.
Yeah, I'm writing this down because I like this idea.
Mm-hmm. And also the comments on the same way. I mean, if anyone here has interesting examples of such networks, right, which would be interesting examples in terms of coupling between the distance, right, and their geometric topological properties, that would be, could be interesting to consider them here, because actually initial idea of Bernard was inspired from lungs, right? I sent also the papers which initially inspired us, one from Christos, one from lungs research. And yeah, feel free to reach us out. And another point, if you will go back one slide, Geoffroy, because actually one more slide, because actually these visualizations, talking about visualizations we discussed with Chakresh and everyone today, they were done by the friend of Bernard, and they were developed, he developed special software for that actually. Like it's not Jeffy, it's not what you know, mm-hmm. it's something else. And
yeah, it's very used actually, this 3D visualization in ecological network visualization for some reason. Because indeed they have hierarchical, they have this hierarchical thing when there's not a source and a drain, but there's basically a super predator and there's a plankton, right? which is kind of in the end similar idea. And they use exactly the same software, and especially the team of Neo Martinez has popularized it in the networks in ecological system. And talking about your other things with spatial network, Yuba, I think that at least from something I've seen a bit is neural, like neuronal networks, because people have a weight of the synapse and you have a distance between neurons. So they have reconstructed a bit similar structural properties where you have edge weights, which could be thought of as your flux here. And they have spatial distance, so you could confront maybe your models to that experimental data that is obtained in many organisms.
Okay, very good idea.
And apart from that, I would obviously, I mean, I think you could talk to Marc Barthélémy about road networks, because I know that they have done studies looking at betweenness centrality in physical networks in general. And also, I think they have looked at similar kind of questioning also. But they have maybe other data that could be of interest to discuss also, but mm-hmm. more like geographic, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have contact with him, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, Chakresh actually asks a question. And Chakresh, if you want to take the floor to ask your question.
What I wanted to ask is that, as Luba just said, that you guys are still looking for certain topological properties that depend on distances between nodes. Can this also be extended for the case of multi-layer networks?
Yeah, that is a good question, because we are working on a very simple structure of network that is just a complex network. Mm-hmm. And that would be of interest to extend this to multi-layer networks. We thought in the first place to study completely flat network, lattice network with various dimension.
Yeah.
And study the effect of dimension on studying the effect of connectivity between nodes, because with the highest dimension, you have most connectivity. But we ended with doing not that. So it would be interesting to study multi-layer networks. I've read a bit about multi-layer network, and I think it will be of interest, yes.
I lost my question. I had another thing in mind, but I lost it. Sorry. Oh no. Okay. I'm sorry. So I looked at something a bit similar in microRNA network in biology. But basically, the idea was it was a case where we were trying to remove the most important nodes in a network, let's say. But we didn't know in advance anything linked to the flux. It would be basically similar to the idea that you would try to remove weakest ties, but you actually don't know their flux in the link. You just know the effect of the removal, right? So you would just compute in a way, like if you remove it, the global flow decreases by that much, right? So I think that's an interesting also thought experiment to think, you know, if you have missing information on your network, so you don't actually know, because it takes time to measure everything, right? So imagine you're in a context where you can only measure the global property. What is the best strategy to make local changes so that you can make the network more sparse and keeping in check the global flow. Or so that's something that is kind of like, if you just have the visibility of the global flow, how does that transform your local strategies? And that's not very easy because obviously there can be, you know, you can make a small global change, but actually be very important later on to the global structure. So it's not completely trivial to think, but I just have this in mind that it can happen that sometimes you don't have the information on the weights, but you want to understand, you just have a global kind of process and you want to understand how it's affected by impact.
Yeah, because in our approach, we have complete knowledge of all the weight on our network. So we can remove the weakest link. We are sure that we are removing the weakest link, but it would be of interest, yes, to remove a local weakest link because we don't have a knowledge of all the network and all the link, and we try to remove just a local weakest link. But
yeah. Or a global in a way, like I'm just thinking, you know, you don't know anything. And what would be if I begin to remove links based on how much their removal impacts the whole, the global flux? What is the strategy actually? Does it compare maybe it compares to the strongest? Or I just wonder if this, you have a very local informative approach, but is it recapped if I were just to look at the global current, basically?
I don't have the answer.
It's just because that it's very linked to this idea of redundancy from before, right? That if they are very different, the global versus the local one, it means that in a way there's a lot of redundancy in the network that is not captured easily at the local level in a way. So it, in a way, it's just another way to have insights on the thing I said before, whether there are antagonistic, like you know, couples of removal that have a much more strongest effect than alone. So it's it was just a comment, but nothing.
Interesting comment. I write it down.
And so to finalize, so like the thing I told earlier about the fact that you can have several communities, I can send you some links because I did a paper on actually where we were trying to model also the perturbation spread in biological network. And because in biological network, we know that we have missing information, we don't know the full network. I was trying to see if it was also robust to removal. So I was looking at these things. And I ended up finding a bit like what kind of properties were making them more robust. And so the networks that were not very robust to this process that were more robust to this process tended to be compartmentalized. And that's something that has been studied in ecological network, like experimentally with ant colony that are actually compartmentalized in different colonies, but have tunnels to go from one to the other. And they have done actual perturbation of node removal in a way.
Okay.
I can send you, it's a Nature paper, because it could be interesting. Like, so they saw the value of modularity in having robustness, more robustness to this process. It could be interesting because I guess that if you have in your system some compartmentalization, there might be an effect of that. And because indeed most real networks, they end up, when they scale, compartmentalizing, it might be relevant to actually to look at that. Even cities, you know, there's roads in the cities, but there's one road between two cities, and there's this kind of, there's this process. And I think it might be relevant to see, now that you have the handle on one community, how it copes with adding another community with some links in between that have a certain property that might not be the same than the links inside the city.
And actually, in the transport, there is a known paradox, which is called metro paradox. When you add one link, right, to the transportation network, and it creates more traffic jams, for example, right? But it's really kind of
paradoxical in a way, right? But at the same time, it's related to this kind of redundancy of like the system is optimal in itself, and you add one more thing, right, to kind of hoping that it will solve the issue, and it will not actually. So,
yeah. Geoffroy?
Mm-hmm. Oui.
I have a question. Did you check when you remove these consecutively these weakest links, do they tend to distribute homogeneously across this QEC, or is the next link weakest link always associated with a node that already had the previous weakest link?
Actually, we didn't test this hypothesis. What happened when you remove one link? The flux are recalculated in the network. And we don't know actually where is located the next weakest flux. I think there is some kind of reorganization of the network that is occurring when you prune it, but we don't really know what happened at the local scale in the network. That will be interesting because it's what we are trying to do in the adjacency matrix, trying to visualize if there is some kind of particular arrangement between spatial arrangement between the links. When you remove one link, does it affect, does the next one to be removed close to the previous one, or is it completely different because the network has been reorganized? And what is tricky when we do that is that we compare several networks at each time. So you can't make a prediction for just one network because it is stochastic, the wiring is stochastic. So what we need to do is to do multiple networks and see if this rule is true for all the networks.
Yeah, but if you were quantifying the gamma for each of your network, you would see if the weakest link is always homogeneously redistributed in the network, you would see a progressive decrease of the gamma, where if it was always removing completely a node before jumping to the next one, you would see jump in your time dependent evolution of the gamma, no?
Yes, probably, but we didn't look at the decrease in the distribution of gamma. Actually, okay. we didn't check that. And another thing that is difficult is that we randomly choose a drain and a source when we initialize the network, and we have to rearrange the adjacency matrix and all the stuff to make sure that all the network are comparable, and we are in the process of doing that. So in the end, we may be able to see locally and spatially if there is some kind of redistribution of the weakest link when we removed it previously. But yes, it's in the paper. It's a French expression translated to English on the fly, but it's on the paper.
So I think we're reaching the end, actually. So that's very nice. It's just 1 hour. And I don't think there is another question, at least from the chat. So thanks a lot, Geoffroy. I think it was very nice because it was a small amount of slides and we could actually discuss a lot. That was very useful, as it was a very nice way to share the findings and explore ideas. So I don't know, Yuva, if there's anything else on your end that you want to add.
No, I think you shared all the slides, or I don't remember. There was one last slide or something. With
no, it was, I think I shared all the slides.
Perfect.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
And yeah. I will stop the recording then.
Thanks a lot,
then.
Mikhail.
Thanks a lot for coming.
And Chakresh and Christos and everyone who came.